Hey guys, Big Dan Bates here from Bates Photography on the road, and today we're back with another RV video. I know, it seems like that's all we do anymore. Fact is, with the lockdown, my photography has been barely existent with the exception of some real estate work, so we haven't had any like fun shoots to take you on. But I got a cool, cheap, easy, and somewhat effective upgrade to talk about today. So today we're talking about the RV stock audio system, which most of you know is crap. Now there's three components to an audio system that depends on how the quality of the system. So you have the head unit, which most RVs come with your standard Jensen or something of the like, basic, cheap, low wattage, low quality system. That's called the head unit. So I have the Jensen double DIN, you know, has the DVD, CD player in it, Bluetooth, multi-channel input. All it seems like it would be a decent system. So that's your head unit. The quality of that is one of the biggest factors in the quality of your audio system. Secondly, of course, are your speakers. So the stock speakers that come with the RV are pretty bad. It's a very thin, small magnet on the back. They are not, there's no polarity. There's no phase. There's no positive and negative. So oftentimes, because of that, how this one's hooked up, say positive left, negative right, maybe opposite of that one over there, now they're out of phase. So when this one's pushing, that one's dropping, and it just doesn't sound nice. And even if they are in phase, they're just crappy paper speakers that this looks like it's a tweeter, but it's really not. It's just a center cone. And I mean, I literally could take my finger, I don't know if I should do this, but I literally could take my finger and just pushed right through it. There is nothing to them, they're crap. So this is the pretty standard speaker, pummel drive, it says. 4 ohms marine speaker, it's just some stock crap. So they're mounted in the ceiling typically, they have this white grill. The white grill on these, you twist it like in an unscrew motion to get it off of those. There's little notches and it just lifts off. And my one had 3 screws in it. The other one had all 6 screws in it. It's luck of the draw, as they say. So you would take this off, you would unscrew these screws and carefully lower it down. Now, carefully for 2 reasons. You don't want this thing dropping and ripping your wires out or swinging into your cabinet. This particular one is very close to my cabinet for whatever reason. So this is now trash. So I'm just getting rid of, well, actually it's not because I got to talk about it. When you take these down, first of all, word of warning. When you pull this down, you are going to get showered with sawdust and bits of insulation and every bit of scrap that when they built your RV, they didn't bother cleaning out when they drilled this hole or when they did whatever. They never bothered to vacuum it out or whatever. As it vibrates and shakes as you're going down the road, it all settles into the speaker because it's the low spot. So when you take this down, just understand you will be vacuuming your RV when you're done. Second thing, we were talking about the phase, how these aren't positive and negative. These come out of your ceiling and they're both standard 1/4 inch spade connectors, which if I do this, I don't know it's going to focus, but your standard 1/4 inch spade connector. So now we're done with him. So I got these Sony, I don't know why they put marine grade speakers in RVs, but because it was a marine grade and I realized there can be a moisture issue, I did also get a marine grade speaker. So let's take their fancy little cover off. So you see this actually has a tweeter. It's a separate component than this. And this is a polypropylene membrane. I can't stick my finger through it. The magnet on this is much bigger. It's a heavier speaker. And again, I don't know if she's going to focus, but if you look how this is real skinny and this is normal. So this is your standard 1/4 inch. Now, when you go to AutoZone or Pep Boys, and you go to a little electrical aisle, you're going to see little boxes like this with the connectors in them. So the one, and this is, these have the red ends. So what that means is they're sized for a wire size of 22 to 18 gauge. And then the blue ones are like 24 to 28. And then the yellow ones are like 18 to 12. It's just how thick your wire is. So I got the reds only because technically blue would be better fitted for this wire size, but I could not find the ones that go on that small terminal in blue. They only had them in red, but I'm gonna show you how to take care of that. So when you look for these, this is standard. It may say 1/4 inch, it may say 0.250, or it could say, 6.4 millimeters. But the skinny one, which is the important one, they're a little tougher to find. They are 7/64, or it may be listed as 0.110 or 0.11, and it also can be listed at 2.8 millimeters. So these are crimp on. So to do this, you gotta cut off the old spade ends because they are crap and they're very loose and they don't even hold on tight even if they're on the right size terminal. So we're gonna start just by cutting those bad boys off. Now we're talking about phases and I jumped ahead because I don't have any sort of a bullet point in front of me. So let's jump back to the second part of your sound system that can determine the quality, and that is your wire. These wires I would gauge with my mass experience in electricity to be around a 24 gauge wire, which is smaller than even these red terminals are made for. That is terrible. This is a 200 watt speaker, and that's probably a 10 watt stereo. But even if I went to an auto parts store and bought a nice doubled in 200 watt stereo and fabricated a custom mount to put it in there, these wires cannot handle the power it takes to drive these good speakers. But I'm going to tell you this, because of these wires are not up to snuff, and I could, I guess, spend a Saturday afternoon with a fish tape and drilling some holes and run new wires if I really wanted to get fancy and spend money on a new head unit. We're not big audiophiles. If I want to listen to music, I'll put on headphones. These speakers for us are strictly for surround sound purposes, so we have the TV. Because these wires limit how well that head unit, even as bad as it is, could drive these speakers better if it had better wires, heavier gauge wires. Let me apologize if you're seeing a lot of cuts to this video. My phone keeps ringing. I just finished work at Kingswick Apartments where I work, Best Garden Apartments in South Jersey. Call and tell them Dan sent you. My phone keeps ringing. There's things going on at my neighbor's here. There's a lot of distractions going on. So you may notice some edits, a lot of chops, but I should be piecing this back together to where it makes sense.
You go to Italy. You lift some weights. You watch a movie. It's all a series of distractions till you die.
So let's talk about the wire. So this wire here is predominantly white. The one white is half black. It's called an indicator stripe. So it's white, half black. Some may be all black, or it may be a blue with a blue stripe, your indicator stripe. That all may vary depending on what it is you're working on. But for this application, this would be the left channel. So it's white with the black indicator. The speaker back over the camera there is actually a medium gray wire with a black indicator. Anytime you have a wire with an indicator when you're dealing with audio, it's just about things being in sync and in phase, meaning that your negative is your negative across the board, your positive is your positive across the board. So anytime I'm dealing with any type of wiring, and if I'm dealing with a polarity, such as positive and negative, the black, always by default for me, is negative. And it doesn't matter. I can make the black positive and the unmarked wire negative as long as both speaker wires are done the same way. That's not going to matter. As long as they're the same, it doesn't matter how you have these flipped. But for just flow, kindness to the next guy, just the universal standard is if you have a black wire, you make that wire negative. And since they both have a black indicator, whereas the other wire that powers your positive are a different color, one's white, one's gray, indicating left and right channels, you should always make whatever the uniform wire is, or do you both have a black wire, that's what you should make negative. Now, like I said, this is a 24 gauge wire. Like I said, these connectors do from 18 to 22. The lower the number when you're dealing with wire gauges, the bigger the wire. So even though this is all the auto parts store had for audio connectors that were these sizes, the 0.25 and the 0.11, red is the smallest they had down to. Blue would be smaller, but they didn't have these in blue. But it's okay, because here's what we're gonna do. So we're gonna start with the negative side, which is the much skinnier connector, the 0.11 or 7/64, 2.8 millimeters. So we're gonna start with our black wire and we're gonna strip that down. And I'm gonna strip that a little longer than what I would need, longer than I normally would. So after you strip it, you're gonna give her a little twist. Then I'm gonna fold it over onto itself, not over to the insulation, just copper to copper, a matching length. So I'm folding the exposed wire in half. So that just now doubled that wire size, which serves no purpose. It can't conduct any more power or anything else, but it now made that wire fatter. So when I put this larger terminal on here, it's going to give it more to bite onto, so it's less likely to pull off or come loose. So we're gonna stick this bad boy on here, and then I got my crimpers here, we're gonna crimper down. All right, so once you're all the way in, you actually wanna see some of your wire kind of coming out of the front there, and there's a little step up that the insulation will hit against to kind of block it. So you have different prongs on your things here, and it'll tell you, this one's for 18 to 22, this one's for 16 to 10, this one's for non-insulated. So this is a 22 to 18 connector. So that's the one I'm gonna use. And I wanna grip that right about in the middle. So on this connector, there's a fatter side, then it steps down halfway, and there's the thinner red, and then it's the exposed connector. I wanna crimp on that thinner red portion. And we're just gonna give that a good hard squeeze, gorilla grip it. And that will never come off. I could swing from that. My monster hands here. So we're gonna do the same thing to the white side. Now the white side again is positive. That's getting that proper quarter inch connector, 0.25, 250, 1/4, it may list it as 1/4. Same thing, we're gonna get that on there. It's 16 to 22 or 18 to 22, whatever it is, good hard crimp. Give her a tug. Okay, so now they're done. You have your nice new ends. Now sometimes these ends could be a little pushed together, sometimes they're not pushed together enough. So before you make any commitment here, you're going to try these on first. And be gentle with this, because these tabs are only thin metal, and if you bend them too much and mess around too much, they will pop off. So that one went on. It's not super tight, but it's tight enough it's not going to vibrate off. That one pushed on pretty well. A little tighter, that's more how I like it to fit. So because this one was just a hair looser than I would like it to be, the fat one, the positive, I'm just gonna take the tip of my wire crimpers and I'm just gonna slightly just give it a little bit of pressure. And it's just curling, those little curly Q connectors, it's curling them around. And that's just a little bit, and that's now, that should be a much snugger fit. There, that feels much better. Okay, so these are connected. Now, before I go through and start shoving this up and screwing it together, I'm quickly just going to turn on my stereo here just to make sure I have sound coming through it, to make sure there was no issue with the speaker or the wire didn't crimp properly. That's all. Okay, we have sound. So now I feel confident to put this in the ceiling. Now these Sony speakers that we're dealing with here, these are the Marine, the XS-MP1611s. So I got these because they were affordable. And like I said, the total investment after with Amazon Prime, it's like $45, $46. A couple of things to consider when you are looking. If you decide not to go with the Sonys, there's a million other brands out there. Some are as cheap as $20, some are $150. One thing to consider is, this hole is a certain size. Now, when I looked into these, I kind of looked at them, and there'll be specs on the cone, how if it slopes in sharply or if it's straight. You want to make sure that whatever you get fits in here. This does fit in here, but a couple of tricks. First thing, bend your connectors gently so they're more facing straight up. That's going to give you more width-wise this way to that wood. When you put these in, you got to put your grate on first and find your hole alignment and then screw it in like that. And the reason you want to do that is, yes, you can put two screws in to hold it in place, then get your grate and put your other two screws in. but you don't really necessarily have a proper gauge to look at this pattern, and you want it to either be straight this way or straight that way so it looks nice. If you just stick this up there without the grate on it already, you have the potential. I mean, you would use your connectors to go by, but you have the potential to not be as precise as if you just do it as one piece. Because now when I shove these wires up in here and I get that up in that hole, now this fits almost perfectly flush. There's a little bit of resistance. I don't know if it's the insulation or if it's the cone, but once you put your screws in, it cinches up perfectly tight. So I want to put this in and I want to kind of get an eyeball on this to make sure that looks pretty straight. If you did it without this, it may, when you then put this on, it may not be as straight as you would have wanted it to be. So for me, it's just as easy to do it this way. So I'm going to go ahead and get this all screwed together, and then we'll talk about some sound quality stuff. All right, so I have the speaker mounted now. It's all screwed in. It's very secure. The wood, there's a decent thick particle wood, just a square around that area that gives you a good solid bite with screws. So this is an exposed open plate. It's decorative, but you can kind of still see the speakers. I actually don't mind that. So I wanted it aligned kind of in a straight row so that you could see the writing and all. Now the screw covers, because it's open to screw it in, they come with these little white inserts that cover them and they just disappear. So these kind of go in such a way where there's two little hooks. They go towards the outside of it first. They kind of hook in and then they just snap right up and those screw holes just disappear completely. One thing I like about this, I'm a fan of Sony in general. We're Sony shooters when it comes to cameras. I always prefer Sony Electronics when it comes to television, stereos. They seem to make a better product than most, but it's the little things. As somebody who's always fixing things, and I'm the one everybody else calls to fix their things, nothing irks me worse than when I get there and I open up a brand new package of some part and it's short two screws, or one of the screws are defective, or one of the connectors are missing or melted or broken. They give you, I think I got 12 of these. So you need 8, 4, and 4, and then you give you 4 spares. So if one ever falls as you're traveling or gets lost, they give you spares. So that was nice. Actually, I'm looking at my toolbox now. I see 2. So they give you 10. So they actually send you 2 extras of these little snapping covers. And it's little stuff like that that, to me, goes a long way. Because for that half a cent, you're making a customer happy when they're missing one, and evidently you just can't go and buy one. So that's in. That's a finished install. Literally took a few minutes. The longest part of all that was cutting off the old ends and crimping on your new, better quality ends. And so that's it. So I want to flip her on. Don't know the camera really can pick up the quality of it all. But you know what? Let's talk about that for a second. I am well disheveled here. I'm all out of timing. I didn't write a list or anything. And like I said, there's been a ton of distractions here. The investment in these speakers, $45. We'll call it a half an hour of my time. Actually, didn't take a half an hour. It's only taking a half an hour because I'm filming. Probably could do this whole project in under 15 minutes. The quality upgrade, the upgrade you're getting, like I said, it's dictated more than just the speakers. It's the wire, namely why you're never going to get a good quality sound. The head unit, you know, these are much better speakers when you compare them to this head unit. The difference is noticeable. When we use these for our surround sound, they're very flat, they're very monotone, very tinny, very hissy. And even with this volume turned up, it still isn't that great. And the higher you turn it, the more distorted the sound was. What I'm finding with these speakers is they're about 1.5 times louder. I wouldn't say they're twice as loud. They're about 1.5 times as louder than the stock speakers. They are probably double in sound quality and probably double in clarity. Now, by clarity, I mean how much you can turn it up before you start getting that distortion. And when using at a nominal volume, it's the words and the sounds and the instruments are just clearer. It is a quality speaker. It's an affordable speaker, but it's still a quality speaker. So I will say, for music, it's an improvement. But for what we're using it for, it's probably going to be a major improvement for my particular uses. No matter how you look at these, it's worth the investment. It's enough of an improvement, regardless if you use it for music, if you use it for audiobooks, if you use it as a part of surround sound of your entertainment center. The investment is so minimal that even though it's a moderate improvement, it's not a great improvement, it's enough of an improvement that it's going to make my life better. And the $40 and half an hour involved is well worth it to me. So let's see if I can't get these audio samples to work. And I'm just going to turn it on now. Like I said, I don't know that we're going to see anything, that you're going to hear anything through the camera that's going to make you swoon. But now that they're both hooked up and I can get it back into stereo mode, I just had it on left channel here. See, once you go in stereo, it's night and day compared to the other system. In mono channel is harder to tell, but on stereo, the whole room is just filled with sound now. So again, you're not shaking your windows. Your neighbor's not going to complain about the bass. They're only 6.5-inch speakers. But the improvement is well noticeable and well worth the investment. And that's all I got to say. I'm wrapping it up.